We respectfully request the Sangha of Great Virtues, for the sake of this assembly and all living beings, please turn the wonderful Dharma wheel to teach and guide us out and birth and death, leave suffering and attain bliss, and quickly realize non-birth. Kung den dai de hup tang ten vi thu pha hoi kâm nhạc thiết chung sanh tịnh duyên diệu vào luân giao đạo ngã môn như há liêu sanh thoát tư ly khổ đạt lạc thất chứng vô sanh. Amen. Is it a blessed, noble, and perfectly enlightened one? Namo Sadanto Suche Doye Alahudi San Miao San Puto Sye. Namo Tak Tak Tha Toya Daya Alahade Tam Yiu Tam Bo Da Toa. The unsurpassed, profound, subtle, and wonderful Dharma, 100,000 million aeons, is difficult to encounter. Now that I'm able to see and hear, I will receive and maintain it. I vow to fathom the thus come one's true and actual principles. Wu shang sheng sheng wei miao fa ba he qian wan jie nan zao yu wo jin jie wen de shou qi yuan jie ru lai zhe shi yi. O Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, Great Master Wei Neng, Great Master Xun Hua, O monks and nuns and all good advisors, Amitabha. Chư Phật Bồ Tát, kính thưa Lục Tổ Thượng Niên Hoa, quý thầy cô các vị vị thiện, trí thức A Di Đà Phật. Chư Phật Bồ Tát, Liêu Chủ Sư Phụ, Sang Rần, Ngư Vệ Chư Sư Rần, Ngư Vệ Sang Chư Sư, Amitabha. Hello everyone, today is the 15th of January 2022. We are gathered here to continue discussing the first chapter of the Six Patriarch Sutra. We are right now on slide 351. All right. Suddenly he saw the verse and said to the court artist, "There is no need to paint. I'm sorry that you have been wearied by coming so far."
忽见奇迹报言，供奉却不用画，劳而远来。
So, 352. The fifth patriarch saw Sheng Xiu's verses on the wall. Therefore, he turned to the court artist and apologized and said, "Looks like I've been inconvenienced you for nothing. I don't think you should do any work today. Okay, I apologize." And this is where the fresco corridor that the fifth patriarch decided to use as an ornament to the Chanwei place to document in terms of a fresco the lives of the first five patriarchs from Bodhidharma to himself. Okay, so because typically back then this fifth patriarch temple was far away in the wilderness. And that's why the court artists had to go from quite a distance for work. So as a teacher, as a patriarch, when he saw this opportunity to teach, he said, this is more important than adorning the way places. Okay, so you see, there are priorities in the teacher's work. So apparently, at the time, the fifth patriarch had a lot of free time, a lot of resources. That's why he decided to do the fresco walls. So this is one of the type of work where you embellish and build away places instead of like Master Xunhua, who really wasn't paying much attention to it, to his way places. And he never built anything big or significant at all. All right, 353. The sutra says, that which has marks is empty and false. Leave this verse for people to recite and uphold.
经云,凡所有相皆是虚妄,但留此记与人诵持。
So the fifth patriarch, 354, those who cultivate in accordance with this verse will not fall into the evil destinies and will attain great benefit.
依此记修免堕恶道,依此记修有大利益。
And so the fifth patriarch immediately convened these disciples, and he says, regarding this verse here on the wall, he quotes the sutra, saying that anything that has marks, okay, marks, again, this is a very important Buddhist concept, Chan concept in particular, where marks are things that are observable that by our sense organs. So what has marks? Marks has form because it's recognized by the eye organ, okay? Marks, anything that has marks might have a smell, which is recognized by our nose organ. A mark could be among the taste, meaning that whatever you taste, you can taste, is recognized by the tongue organ. Anything that has form, taste, what else do we have again? Touch, okay? Anything that you can touch with your skin that comes into contact with your skin, that would be received by your body organ, your skin organ, and that is a mark. What else is a mark? Anything that is taste, smell, sound. Oh, thank you very much. Anything that has a sound is a mark. So sound is a mark that is recognized by the ear organ. Okay, and finally, anything that the mind recognizes is also has a mark. That is the concept, for example, is a mark. Okay, let's say the beauty or the artistry that the mind appreciates, that's a mark as well. Creation, creativity is also conceived, can be appreciated by the mind, is also a mark. So anything that has a mark, okay, and the sutra says, is fundamentally empty and false. Empty here refers that it is has no self-nature. Basically, it is there based on conditions, okay? And therefore, in particular, it is basically illusions because they are perceived by our sense organs. Think about it. Anything that you perceive through your sense organs are fundamentally, basically empty and false. Okay? False, this is very, very important. False here refers to the fact that our sense organs, okay, make it look like they're real, but they're not. They actually we are being fooled by our own sense organs. And this is why for the, as far as Buddhism is concerned, it's very difficult to teach worldly people because the worldly people have a hard time accepting this fact that our sense organs are false, meaning that whatever measurements, whatever we can register, actually is false. It's not real. Any problems here? For example, Chanel number 5 is false. Can you believe? So, because when you have whatever you inhale is false. Isn't that incredible? That beautiful woman that you like is false. What happened to the real man here? Daniel, would you like to say anything? What about that concept called, continue? Can you finish my sentence for me, please, Daniel? You know where I'm going? Someone help this Catholic out. Hello, help me out, please. The Catholic. Shaking your head too? No, my words are not false. This is a request. Give an example of something conceived by the mind is false. Daniel. Spy number 2, help him out. Teamwork. Three.
Love is forever.
Oh, it sounds like music to my ears. I would accept it if you really believed it. But you didn't mean it, did you? Use a microphone because the internet people would like to hear this.
Master, I thought you said it was something that the mind believed, but it's false.
Do you really believe it? That's what I'm asking. Do you believe it? That love is false?
I do believe it's false.
Okay. You continue to surprise me. Okay, anyone else would like to give me an example of something conceived by the mind is false? Daniel now has awakened to the truth of the universe. Go ahead with that preface. Please give us something profound that we Buddhists can aspire to, can appreciate.
I think that anything that is worldly is false.
What?
Anything that is worldly is false. Anything that comes from the world is false.
too shallow. Anyone else? Anyone else would like to help me out here? Huh? What is God? I'm not seeing any hands. What is God? Yes, seven. Thank you.
Chun says, God is false.
Yes, three. Come to the rescue.
God is real as verified by Master Yonghua and the Buddhist.
Traitor, not only is she a spy, she's also a traitor, using my own teaching against me. That is low. Yes, eight.
Sir, false things may be God is almighty.
I'm sorry?
God is almighty.
God is almighty, which is?
Not true.
Which is false. Concepts about gods are false because those are projections of the mind. By this definition of six patriarch, here is a proof that they cannot blame me. I mean, Daniel and his beloved cannot blame me for fabricating this. I'm only interpreting the six patriarch's teaching, which he quoted the sutras, Buddhist sutras. This is Buddhist wisdom. God, concepts about gods, whether he's almighty, omniscient, and all those things, are projections of the mind. Whoever said it first basically used the mind to project it. Okay, and therefore, those concepts are false. Yes, defend yourself, Catholic.
That's where the confusion comes, because then what would be considered as non-attachment as real? For example, even if you say he comes from Buddhist wisdom, then that could be false because it's presented by the mind still. So what cannot be presented by the mind?
That's our little Buddhist secret. We can't reveal everything to you, non-Catholic people, can we? Huh? Go ahead, answer him, girlfriend. Let's see how deep you understand my teachings.
Well, because we are on the Six Patriarch Sutra today, that is false. If not, then I have a question. If God, the concept of God is false, then what about the concept of Bodhisattva and Buddhas? Are they false or true?
Just as I suspected, you came from the wrong side of the railroad tracks. That's why you're confused. It's a waste of time. Anyone else? We'd like to answer her. Answer them. Soju, Suni. You had your saying, give the Buddhists a chance. Yes.
Oh. I'm so sorry, Master.
You have nothing to say?
Yes.
Okay, the rest of the Koreans. Koreans in Korea, Koreans here, please help your own kind. Which is also a false concept, right? That is false too. That sound is also false. That noise is also false. Isn't that wonderful? Anyone else here? Jumi, help your favorite Sunim out. You don't have that many favorite Sunims left. Okay, I give you a second chance, Catholic. Don't blow it again.
I think one day you said that only when, well, not only, but one of, when you're in Somali, that would be true.
Are you contradicting yourself?
No, but I'm just trying to clarify.
You can't have it both ways. Okay? First you say everything is false, and then next you say, but except for samadhi. That's not true. Anyone else? This is a good question. I mean, this he made a good point. How are we going to defend ourselves? He says, if you call my God false, then I call you Buddha false. I call you Sutra false. It's fair. He doesn't drive, so we can't do anything. We can't find a car to mutilate. So what can we do? Mutilate a girlfriend's car. Yes, 9.
So God is real, Buddha is real, Bodhisattva is real. The problem is what you think they look like, what you think they are, that's a false thought.
Which side are you on? Buddhist or Catholic? You cannot say I'm both Catholic and Buddhist. No, God is real, Buddha is real, everything is real. That's anti-Buddhist.
I'm Buddhist.
Anyone else? Yeah, I'm sorry. Tonight we're very sparse in population, in attendees, because in the U.S. there is a, this is a long weekend. People are either in Las Vegas or in Reno playing, you know, exercising. Yes, given A.
Ayira Phap, thank you, Master. Theo Kong Ye, thì whatever we think right now is false until we get to the level of biết cái tự tâm bên trong của mình á, sư phụ, chân tâm của mình á, thì lúc cái biết đó thì mình sẽ biết là nó real. Right now, it's not.
Master, I think like right now, whatever we think is false until we really recognize our true mind, our true nature, then that is real.
Yes, 7.
Alta D says, is everything real and false at the same time?
Get out of here. Stay home. Anyone else? Yes, 7.
No, 1596 says, does false mean impermanent?
No, false means false. I mean, there's true and there's false. What else, how else can we explain false? False is something that is not true. Anyone else? I wanted to have a survey to see which one is my favorite disciple. There's the one who, Buddhist, and who gave me the right answer. That's why I didn't react to any of you, except for a few ludicrous answers. Q&A, go ahead. See if this is my favorite disciple or not.
A Di Đà Phật, dạ thưa thầy, con nghĩ rằng cái gì mà không sinh ra, không diệt thì cái đó mới là thật.
Master, I think whatever does not produce, does not distinct, that is the real one.
Okay, I haven't heard from real Chinese people yet. The Chinese are so proud, they say, you know, hey, this is our dharma, not yours. That's the extent of the Chinese understanding. Go ahead, Q&A.
I'm not real Chinese, but I think samadhi, if the question is samadhi real or false, I think samadhi is not false because it's not perceived by your senses. It's not marks. So it's not false.
Wait. You're Chinese? Are you represented Chinese or American? I look at you, I cannot tell.
I don't know what our master says.
Okay. What? What did you say, honey?
Don't know.
You don't know. Oh, okay. Go ahead, Kong. Oh, finally, the Koreans awakened. Hello?
Hello, Master.
See, I knew it. Hello?
Hello? Yeah. Master, I'm really not 100% Korean. Is that okay?
I take any Korean stuff. Kimchi, bibimbap.
So for responding to Chen's answer, Chen's answer, if you enter samadhi and then if you think about the samadhi or you have feeling about the samadhi, then the concept of samadhi might be false. Because once you are out of samadhi, you think about it.
So far, no Korean is my favorite disciple. Yes, seven.
Gold Force Daniel says, false or real depends on your state. And Daniel Wisniewski says, life is false.
Okay, all right. Finally, Shouju Sunim came back down to earth.
Master, I think to us, everything is real. But the person who get enlightenment is everything is empty and false.
Do you, the rest of you Koreans, agree with that or not? I want Jung Yin Sunim. This is when I need him, yes or no? Jung Yin Sunim.
Yes, Master.
Answer. Don't say yes, Master. Do you agree with Soju Sunim or not?
I'm not agree to the Sanju Sunim.
So what do you agree, what do you think?
The 신은 진짜로 있다고 생각합니다. 그리고 그 신은 부처님을 섬기는 존재라고 생각합니다.
This is before you translate Sangguk Sunim. To remember, this is a matter of national pride. Is the Korean better, or Vietnamese better, or Chinese better now?
I think God exists. I think God serves Buddha.
Say what? Okay, let's give the Vietnamese a chance way in the back there. Give him a microphone. The old man, 8.
A Di Đà Phật. Con sorry là con bị ho cho nên con ngồi trong phòng.
Yes.
Cái giả với thật này nè.
Any last wishes?
Cái giả với thật đó thì nãy thầy mới nói là do sáu giác quan mình nhận ra, thì mình có ý kiến là nó tốt hay xấu theo cá nhân mình. Mình nhận ra cái gì đó thích hay thơm hay thúi hay là thích hay không thích, hay là cái mùi, hay là cái tướng, hay là cái vị gì đó. Thì Phật nói gì nó thay đổi cho nó giả. Cũng thường cái hoa mà một người hít vô thì thích thích, một người khác allergy thì chửi, nó không thích, tôi không thích cái mùi này, nên nó giả. Còn nói theo Kinh Hoa Nghiêm á, các vật đều nó có cái nhân duyên, condition, nó thành tựu cái gì đó. Ví dụ giờ một bó rôm, mình liệu vô lửa nó cháy, lơm với lửa nó không biết nhau, rồi cháy hết thì thôi. Liệu bó rơm lớn nó cháy lâu, nó không có cái tôi và cái ta, cái người gì trong đó hết. Tại mình vô minh, mình nhận cái này là tôi, cái này là anh, cái này là chị, cái này vợ, cái này chồng. Rồi nó sinh ra cái giả, cái thích, không thích, rồi nó lại thay đổi. Dù quý vị tự nhìn trong cái tâm mình coi, trước khi mà mình khởi cái gì đó, nó có cái khoảng trống, nó không có cái gì hết á. Cái đó Đạo Phật gọi là cái biết. Con chim, con trùng, con dế nó cũng có cái đó nữa. Cái biết. Awareness ability. Trước khi nó khởi lên thương với ghét, nó có cái đó. Mà quả báo nó thành con ong, quả báo thành rồng, quả báo thành một người nam, người nữ, người Mỹ, người Mỹ trắng, người Mỹ đen. Rồi cái biết nó giống nhau. Thì khi mình khởi lên, mình chấp cái đó, mình khổ, Đức Phật chỉ cho mình cái upside down của mình để mình chữa đi. Chúa cũng là cái biết, nhưng mà cái quả báo thành Chúa Giêsu, thành Chúa Đức Chúa Trời, các vị dân trời. Rồi cũng có cái sự thay đổi vậy. Hồi Phật tại thế có một vị trời nữ chết, đầu thai xuống đây. Mà vẫn còn nhớ trên chồng con trên đó, người ta hỏi Đức Phật, thật là tại cái bà này mà chết, nhưng mà còn nhớ cái phước báo. Bà còn nhớ chồng con ở trên kia. Cho nên cũng có sự đau khổ chia cách, là phải với chồng với con mình xuống như này. Cũng thay đổi cái duyên giống lửa với rơm mình mới nói đó. Mà có cái không sanh không diệt là cái biết của mình đó, là Phật đó. Kêu bằng Buddha, Awareness, Ability. Ai cũng có cái gì tự phản chiếu bây giờ nè. Phản chiếu bây giờ thấy chứ không cần phải nhập định. Mà mình giữ không được lâu là mình vừa khởi lên là mình khởi cái khác, là mình phiền não theo. Cho nên mình tập, mình tu. Mình giữ cái đó lâu thì mình hạnh phúc, mà mình không giữ lâu là mình khởi sân si lên là mày đủ chuyện hết. Bây giờ cái gì niệm Phật cũng vậy. Nam mô A Di Đà Phật. Tổ Phò nó có khoảng trống, nó nhìn coi. Nó có khoảng trống cái tâm mình đó. Lúc mà Tổ Phò nó không có cái gì hết đó. Rồi Hòa Thượng Tuyên Hóa dạy là quán thoại đầu, thoại vĩ. Nó quấy tổ gì của cái người đại hàng đó. Trước khi mình khởi cái ý nghĩ lên đó, thì cái khoảng trống phía trước không có gì hết đó. Rồi thổi vĩ là vừa nghĩ xong cái ý nghĩ nó chết đi, thì ở sau đó cũng không có cái gì hết đó. Cái chỗ đó là lục tổ, ví dụ như empty sky với cái lightning stroke đó. Lightning stroke là tự nó thứng analogy cho cái ý nghĩ của mình. Còn empty sky là cái biết đó, cái awareness đó. Thế vậy, quý vị tự phản chiếu trong ai cũng có cái đó, không chờ nhập định đâu. Mà cái mình giữ không được lâu thôi. Con xin hết.
Master, first of all, I would like to apologize that because I'm coughing, so that's why I was staying in my room. And talking about what we've been discussing, whether it's true or it's false, it's through the perception of the sixth organ. And each of us, we have a self that we give rise to the thought like, okay, I like it, I don't like it. And the Buddha say, because things is keep changing, that's why it's false. And for example, if let's say it's a flower, and then a person like it and say, okay, it's real. But a person that has allergy didn't like it and say, no, it's not real. So in the Flower Adornment Sutra, I say that all things are created by cause and condition. So for example, if it's a straw was catch a fire, and then it will get burned, and then once it's burned, and then the fire will be extinguished. And so it's the same thing with whether you like it or not liking it. It's just based on the condition. And so the Buddha show us, like, in your mind, before you give rise to any thought, there is an empty space. And that is what the Buddha called the awareness ability. And because of our retribution, then we will have different form. For example, it's man or woman or Caucasian or black people or whatever. And then we use our discrimination mind to see the different. And the Buddha showed us that we need to get rid of that discrimination mind. And then, for example, talking about God is because of the retribution. Then he will have a different body. And then there was a story that say that this woman, after she died, she was born into the heaven and become a god, but because she was still remember missing her husband and her children, and then down that were still on the earth, so that's why she couldn't let go, and then she was suffer. The Buddha say that the awareness ability that is something that is not produced and that is not distinguished. And that is the Buddha nature. Everybody have it inside us. So you just need to reflect upon it, and then you don't even need to enter samadhi. As long as you can aware of it, then you can see it. So he also gave an example, like for example, if you recite Namo Amitabha, the way that we do ceremony, and then when we circumambulate, and then when it comes to mi, to, and fo, and we prolong it, the sound prolong a little bit longer. So between the two sound, to and fo, you can see that there is an empty space, and it means that there's nothing in there, and it's similar to the hua tou. You can contemplate on the head or the tail of the hua tou. So the head of the hua tou is like before you give rise to any thought, that is an empty space. And then after the thought give rise and it dying down, that is the tail. Then after that is also an empty space. You just need to contemplate on the empty space. So it's similar to the analogy of it is similar to the blue sky with the lightning stroke. So you just need to keep focus on that empty space.
Yes, Seven.
Cordelia says, anything with sense is false. Once the mind is empty, that's when you see the true nature. And she added, when I'm not thinking, everything is there, but I don't feel attached to it. The more I practice, this non-attachment lasts longer.
Okay.
Also, Null 1596 says, do false thoughts mean the thoughts are not your own? And Alex also has a comment. The truth is dependent, arising in emptiness. Their union is Buddha nature, and the truth of that can't be experienced through any one passing thought.
Okay. Nine.
Master, it depends. For us, our regular people, ordinary people, who believe everything is true. And for the enlightened being, Master Huineng say that everything with marks is empty and false without characteristic. So with the enlightened people, they think that everything with mark is false.
Yes, Catholic, last chance.
My problem will be more like the concept for even to enter in samadhi. They say that it's still a concept for to me at least. for me, it still comes from the thoughts. For even like trying to see empty space, as the venerable was saying, for me, still seeing or like everything that has to come to the mind. So therefore, to me, it's still going to be false. So how do you know when it's false or when it's real?
Okay, anyone else? Very good. You have a good survey. Yes, seven. One more comment.
I just wonder, is it just the Buddha nature is true and everything else is false?
Okay. Anyone else? Well, finally, we have a viewpoint from a Caucasian person. Wow, we have a full representation already. Who else are we missing? Anyone else? What happened to Chinese people? Real Chinese people. Okay, how about real Koreans in Korea? Not half Korean in Korea. Okay, this is a very, very good point. Buddhism, in Buddhism, we keep on talking about things that are false. Things are false, they're all empty, and they're false. What does it really mean? And then what is true? So this is the kind of questions that we Buddhist teachers need to be prepared to answer, okay? Some of you gave the correct answer, and most of you gave the wrong answers, of course. Okay? Let's not worry so much about right and wrong. Let's talk about why did the six Paccha teach about false and empty and so forth. Okay? It's for the fact that if you cannot see the real truth behind appearances, then you will suffer. You will create karmas. And that's why you will continue to suffer. That's why it's important to distinguish what is true and what is false. Can we agree on that, all of you? Buddhism is very practical. It's not like, oh, it's empty, it's false, and you say, oh, how wonderful principle. No, it's not like that at all. You can stay at that level, scholarly level, intellectual level, and say, Buddhism is so profound, everything is so empty, everything is so false. Okay, that's true. You can talk at that level. But actually, it's more meaningful than that. It's much deeper than that. What is meant? What do I mean by deeper? Deeper because it's very useful. It's not a concept. If you stay at a scholarly level where everything is false, and intellectual level where this is a profound teaching, then it's still false. You agree or not? Buddhism is meant for you to look at that and utilize it. If you utilize it properly, then you benefit from Buddhism. If you don't utilize those Buddhist concepts, then they are basically are false. Even those concepts of Buddhism where it says that which has mark is empty and false is also false. Because it basically, they are words. That's it. Can we agree on that? This is about you. Not about the Buddhas. It's not about sutras. It's about you. If you do the wrong things, then you will suffer because you mistake the false for the true. Is it clear? We're learning this because If we Buddhists are saying that what you know you are suffering and there's no end to it, and this now the Buddha explained a little bit further. He said you're suffering because you mistake the false of the true. Therefore, you create the wrong karmas, the bad karmas. That's fundamental to the Buddhist concept of true and false. If your mind, on the other hand, your mind is able to discern the true, then you will not create the wrong karmas anymore, and therefore you will stop suffering. If you enjoy suffering, no need to learn about the true and the false. But if suffering bothers you, if aging bothers you, if sickness bothers you, okay, those are the suffering that arise from your mistaking the false for the true and thus created karmas in the past. On the other hand, say I'm talking about normal people, yes? Who's not bothered by sicknesses? We all are, right? And we are sick because we create karmas in the past. We mistook the false for the true and acted upon that knowledge. And therefore, it's very important for us, if we want, I repeat, we want to stop our suffering, put an end to all suffering, you have to recognize the truth. Once you recognize the truth, you will cease to create more karmas, and therefore, no more suffering. Okay? In what way? This is important. In the way that because you recognize the false, and therefore, you no longer are creating new karmas that will create future sufferings. Is that clear? So future sufferings end. Yes, it's no more new karmas. So far, so good. However, even if you recognize the truth, what happens to the past karmas? They keep on coming. Yes? How does it end your suffering? This is a very important distinction, folks. It's true that when you create new karma, you stop creating new karmas, you are no longer having future sufferings. Straightforward reasoning. Yes? Logic. However, what about past karma you created? They're still being pushed forward in the pipeline. Okay? What happens to them? They're still coming. How does recognizing the truth from the false, discerning the truth from the false, stop all suffering at all? I'm helping you because no, you cannot, you don't know how to ask that question. That's why I have to ask it for you. Now, Kong.
Recently, I met somebody at the Jokong. I realized we are maybe looking at the wrong side of the problem, because no matter what you do, how high level you are, this will never stop coming. So you need to look at the other side, like how that leads you thinking and then continue to think more. Then maybe you will have a chance to improve that area of thinking a lot and suffer.
You get what she said? Too Korean. Can you speak in English, please?
Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah, so I felt because your karmic retribution will keep coming and harass you, you need to look at the other side. Why they
We need to look into Catholicism, the other side. We need to look into the RBA, the other side. What other side?
Your mind.
The mind has two sides? Why, that's new to me. Yes, Seven.
If you see that everything is false when your past karmas arise, wouldn't it not bother you because you can recognize it's false?
Once you see everything is false, when past karmic retributions come and inflict suffering upon you, what is suffering? What is suffering? I'm giving you this example to help you be prepared for the future. People like me, Smart Alex, who sit in the audience, going to ask you, you Buddhists keep on talking about suffering and true and false. Okay, they ask you this kind of question. How are you going to answer it? Yes, by number two.
Master, the other, like Venerable Xianan say, looking at the other side of your question, the answer, suffering, what is, I am suffering because my karmic retribution from the past has been hitting me and I'm suffering a lot. My car keep having problem and it has problem every year in January or something and it's getting worse and worse. And may I repent, Master?
No. Let's not change subject. Nice try. Number nine. She said, I really like what you're talking about. May I repent? That's false. Compliment. Yes, nine.
My car also has problem too.
It's also false.
Also temple.
You cannot believe how opportunistic the Americans are here. It is so shameful. I feel so ashamed to be American because we are so opportunistic, so seeking small gains and untrue to ourselves. Q&A.
So, Master, I think suffering is when your ego doesn't like something. Your ego doesn't like it. That's suffering.
Okay. Suffering is a mental construct. You decide it's suffering. Whereas Jumi decides it's pleasure. We agree? You agree, Jumi? What we feel is suffering, she said, oh, that's so much fun when you're suffering. I rest my case. She cannot argue against that argument. Huh? Make sense? See? Yeah. She's beginning to learn. Imagine you left. You have missed out all these important teachings. Yes, you see that? So suffering is a mental construct. Suffering comes from recognition of your mind. Therefore, it is false to the person who can see the truth. If you cannot see the truth, that's why you look at suffering as true. But those who can see the truth, they can then, they are able to rise above the suffering, the concept of suffering already. So they say, what suffering? What leg pain? What sickness? Is that clear? So that's why once you see the truth, it's no more suffering, because you're not creating more karmas for you to suffer in the future. And whatever karmas you create in the past, when the retributions come, those so-called sufferings will not bother you anymore. That's why we Buddhists can claim that once you see the truth, you never suffer again. QED. End of demonstration. You're not impressed. Say, what? This is brilliant. I might say, I might add. Yes, one.
I really find it quite deep, because we are our own guinea pig. You know, we are our own litmus test as to what we actually believe. Not what is on the screen and not what you say, but how much we can actually absorb and accept.
Anyone else? No, Catholic, this is way beyond you. So, anyone would like to give me examples of what they feel suffering, I will comment on it for you. For example, that many quite often to us, and to virtually all of us, go ahead, Q&A.
A Di Đà Phật, lời dạy giảng của thầy làm con nhớ lại cái sự tích của ngài Mục Kiền Liên. Là khi ngài đã đắc đạo rồi thì ngài biết rằng ngài có một cái nghiệp là phải chết chém. Cho nên ngài tự đi tìm ra cái chợ chỗ mà người ta hai ông hàng thịt nó đang đấu nhau đó, thì ông đi vào đó để ông lãnh cái quả báo. Thì khi mà ông bị chặt chém như vậy thì rất là đau, nhưng mà ông không có khổ. Là bởi vì thứ nhất là cái ngã ông không còn, thứ hai á, là ông đã vượt qua được cái khổ của cái tâm. A Di Đà Phật.
Master, whatever you just taught us remind me about the story of Mahamagaliyana. After he attained enlightenment, and then he knew that he has a karma that he needs to pay, that he will die from being stabbed. So he himself went to the market, and then there was the two butcher was fighting with each other. He walked in, and then they stabbed him. So he died from it, even though it was so painful, but it was not suffering to him because he has no more self, and that's why it's not bothering him. It's not suffering to him.
Okay, very good. So if you see the truth, then you see that all marks, that which has marked, is empty and false. So far, so good. This is what it's referring to. When you reach that state of being, be able to see the true, which is when you are able to see your self nature. No one asked me that, so I need to specify it for you. To see the truth is when you see your self nature. Before that, you cannot see the truth. Is it clear? When you can see your nature, then you can see the truth, and there's no more suffering. Okay, you put an end to all suffering. And that's why the next part of the comment of the sutra, okay, it says, those who cultivate in accordance with this verse, the fifth patriarch says, those of you who cultivate in accordance with this verse, okay, meaning that those of you practice like this, you see the truth, will not fall into the evil destinies and will attain great benefits. That's what the fifth patriarch meant. Okay? He meant that if you cultivate according to this verse, eventually you will see the truth, therefore you will put an end, you will not commit the destinies, and the evil destinies are attaining great benefits. Are we clear on what the fifth patriarch's teaching was? This is correct. So far, so good. Okay, let me go a little bit further for you. Okay, because this teaching is for babies. You are way beyond that. So that's why I'm teaching you about these concepts, because I look upon you in the future for people who come and learn Buddhism from you to ask these types of questions, especially professors or scholars who come and ask you this. Okay, and that's why I want you to be prepared, because they cannot answer it themselves. That's why they don't ask themselves, among themselves, these types of questions. Okay, because they cannot recognize the truth. That's why they're not going to ask questions that will embarrass themselves. Right? They deal with concepts which are all false. So the answer to the original question is, and then a few of you did give me the right answers, and I commend all of you on those. In particular, the old monk got it right, but his explanation could be improved a little bit, could be more succinct instead of citing too many things. What you want to do is make a point, and then give an example. Make a point, give an example. If you jump from example to example too often, people will lose your point, will miss the point. Okay? So something you should work on, but that's not bad. Your answer is not wrong. It could be improved. Okay, now, so the answer to my original question is, I answer a few of the points that were raised, okay? If you're in samadhi, can you see the truth? No, you can't. Remember, my definition is that you cannot see the truth until you see the self nature. You become enlightened. Just to be in samadhi does not mean that you are enlightened, because there are many samadhi levels. Samadhi is a generic term that describes the state of concentration at various levels. It's a special state of mind. Okay? And that's why, just because you're in samadhi, and the thoughts don't arise and so forth, because you cannot see the minute thoughts yet. That's why you think your mind is empty, but it's not. Okay? So anyway, so samadhi has little to do with the false or the true. Okay? All right. Did I miss anything else? Now that the point you made earlier when I went through, when we spent 20 minutes asking you and you presented your viewpoints, is there anyone who would like me to answer his or her viewpoint directly, yes or no, agree, disagree? I want to make it clear, because we went through a lot of different concepts, different positions, different stands. So I want to make sure that you all heard, and you can insist on your point being commented by me. Think about it. Okay? Okay. So the premise is this, about why there's the teaching has says, which has marked is empty and false. Okay? This is a teaching for people like us who are not enlightened yet. Okay? If you're not enlightened yet, this teaching is exactly for you. Meaning that, why is it empty? If you see things that you're not enlightened yet, whatever you are very attached to, red cars, money, fame, reputation, love, okay? When you attach all those things, it's false. It's empty and false. Therefore, you should not be attached to it. That's what Buddhism is teaching you. If you don't see it's empty and you keep attaching to money, to love, to red cars and so forth, you will continue to suffer. Simple as that. So far, so good. It's your personal choice. No one is asking you to do what the Buddha says. It's your personal choice. He says, you know, I will no longer attach to kimchi. Wait, that's a bad example. Really? Bad example, that's an exception. You know, liking kimchi is an exception, okay? Okay, so if you insist, let's find a neutral example that offends no one here. If you insist on believing in God, okay, that is false, and therefore you will suffer. Can we agree on that? I mean, the only people who count, can we agree on that? Spy number two. Careful. You give the wrong answer, the car will become worse and worse and worse.
Pardon, what was the question again?
Wrong answer. You cannot answer a question with a question. Anyone else? Okay. Yeah. So, so that's if you are not enlightened yet, okay, anything that you attach to is false, and that's a fantastic teaching. Then you know what to do, don't you? You believe money is real, and you say, "Oh, I don't want to spend money. This is hard-earned money." Okay, hey, and so forth. Then you will suffer because of that, and you will not attain great benefits. On the other hand, you say, well, I'm very attached to money, and I realize that the attachment is false, the attachment to something false. I let go. I give it away to churches, give it away to charities, give it away to Master Yonghua, don't forget that. Then what happens? You will not fall into the evil destinies, and you will attain great benefits, in particular when you give it to me. No one is laughing. Okay, you see that? It's how beautiful it is. How beautiful the teaching is. So this teaching here, again, I emphasize to you, if you're not enlightened yet, this teaching is for you. Everything is false. Everything is empty. Let go. All right? Once you are enlightened, then it's a different teaching. I will not teach you until you become enlightened. All right? That's all. Any questions or comments? Yes, three.
So, Master, that means what Arhatshu would be true.
To who?
To the Arhat.
No.
Well, you
whatever just... a four-stage Arhat understands, thinks, believe, attaches to, is false.
Then what level would it be true then? Bodhisattvas or just only Buddha?
Bodhisattvas. You have to reach a Bodhisattva level before it's true.
Thank you.
Any other questions? In Buddhism, it's very precise. There's no beating around the bush. Okay, you may disagree or you may agree. It doesn't matter. You will find out yourself. Because if you mistake the false or the true, you will suffer. You find out yourself very quickly. Q&A.
Abhidhava Master. My opinion is the mainly Buddha wants to teach us is don't attach to anything. We see things here in life, it's a permanent. Then Buddha teaches that it's is impermanent. And then the sound here, they achieve the impermanent, and Buddha teaching is just things are permanent. So mainly, if you see something and attached to, then you should keep your mind in dwelling in nowhere, like the six-patra sutra.
Oh, I was waiting for translation. Okay, very good.
Master, he's speaking English. What do you want to translate?
Vietnamese? I mean... yeah? There's quite often in every single sentence, and when he spoke, there are some words that are garbled. So I couldn't get quite a few words. Now I can't hear him at all.
Yeah. Amitabha Master, hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Yeah, Beautiful Master, they understand the main teachings Buddha wants to teach us everyone is that we shouldn't attach to anything in life, because attachment is where the suffering come from. So with us normal people, we see life is permanent. Therefore, Buddha's teaching is that everything is impermanent. And then the sound here, when they get themselves to the jungle, because they see things impermanent, so Buddha teach them that things are permanent again. So overall, whatever our mind attached to anything, then that where the suffering come from. So our mind is supposed to not dwell on anything, according to the Six Patras Sutra teaching.
Okay, sounds good. Okay. excuse me. All right. Any other questions or comments? Seven.
See, these are different topics from YouTube.
Yes.
So Cordelia asks, I'm exhausted from lack of sleep, trying not to be attached to it, but when I drive, I feel like I keep falling asleep. How can I deal with this?
You should not drive when you're sleepy. Because if you drive when you're sleepy, you could doze off, pass out, and cause accidents. Okay? And therefore, it's wrong. It's false. Because if you insist on driving when you are drowsy, when you're tired, then you are being attached to that concept of fighting the sleepiness incorrectly. When you say, when you are sitting, crossing your legs, and you're supposed to fight your drowsiness, but when you're driving, it's not the same as doing chan. And driving when you're drowsy is irresponsible. Please stop doing that. You're going to hurt yourself, and your family will get hurt. They will be very upset at me for advising you, and especially Buddhism, for teaching you all the wrong stuff. Okay? Please don't drive when you're drowsy. Please don't drive in particular. Please don't drive when you're fasting. Because when you're fasting, okay, you can, and you drive, if you lack energy, you will pass out. And that's very, very dangerous. Stop it. All right? When you're tired, pull over and rest. Or call a cab, call Uber or something, you know, Lyft or something, so that you don't drive. Okay? Anything else? Question from JMT.
네, 감사합니다. 질문이 있는데요. 마스터 지침을 지키려고 하는 것은 집착이 아닌가요? 예를 들어서 제가 이번 겨울에 미국에 가야 되는 게 어리석게도 지침이라고 생각해서 엄청 노력하다가 가족들과 부딪혀서 괴로움을 겪었었는데 그때 미국에 가는 것이 지침이라고 생각해서 했던 것이 나의 집착이었다는 생각이 들어서 마스터의 지침을 지키려고 하는 것과 집착이 어떻게 다른 건지도 궁금합니다.
I'm trying to follow Master's instruction. Is it attachment? For example, I tried to go to US because I thought it was your instruction. So to follow your instruction, but there's some obstruction and I felt suffering. So I thought it's kind of attachment. So I want to ask you, what's the difference between attachment and following instruction?
Okay. Very good. I don't know. It's too complicated. Number seven.
I have another YouTube question from Wei Liu. Can we go to Pure Land instead of suffering on Earth?
Yes, you can. Absolutely. And you should. You find that, especially when you find, this is a rule of thumb, you find that this life on Earth is so much suffering, then you should definitely try to go to the Pure Land. I highly recommend it. That's the best place for you, where your suffering will end forever. All right? That's the solution for suffering, to end your suffering. And the other way, and which is number one, my first choice. The other choice is that you can cultivate, and you can reach a point in your cultivation where all suffering will end on this earth right now. You don't have to wait until you go to the Pure Land to end your suffering. You can try to do it now. However, to do it now involves a lot of suffering. Well, for if you don't like suffering right now, and you must endure even more suffering to get there, it's probably not feasible for you. It is possible for some of you who are very blessed, you'll be able to do that. But for most of us, we can't. Therefore, number two option is try to cultivate and suffering. This lifetime is only reserved for the elite few, the select few. Majority of us should definitely go to the Pure Land, okay? If I were you, and if suffering, I repeat, if suffering bothers you, okay, and you see no way out of it, you everywhere you turn is suffering. You don't follow Master's instruction, you're suffering. You follow Master's instruction, you're suffering. It's suffering in everything you do. Wherever you look is suffering, then definitely go to the Pure Land. Okay? And what do? The question is about, you know, I follow Master's instruction, I suffer so much, and because I have obstruction. Okay? If I don't follow Master's instructions, then yes, I also suffer. So what to do? Okay? Here's what to do. You can only solve a limited number of sufferings at a time. You cannot fix them all. Okay? So what to do? If you're suffering, you have a lot of suffering. You're suffering from being greedy for food, being greedy for money, being attached to people liking you, being unhappy when people misunderstand you. You hate it that people really don't understand you at all, misunderstand you constantly. That really bothers you. Okay? That is suffering. Okay? You cannot rise above it, then definitely so what happened is that you need to look at what really bothers you first. Okay? So the instruction I give you you cannot execute them all. Okay? So someone said earlier, you know, I was taught to fight sleepiness, the sleepiness, you're supposed to fight it, as I said, when you're sitting, when you're meditating, when you are doing ceremonies at the temple or at home. However, you are not supposed to try to solve it when you're driving. Okay? So, because you can't solve it while you're driving. So that's why you have to make the distinction, okay? When to do it. When you're not clear, ask, like she did. Okay? Again, Ru Shu asked about, you know, I have obstruction everywhere, and I do it. I suffer because I have obstruction. I don't do it. I suffer because I'm unhappy. So what to do? What to do here is to try to cultivate as much as you can. Okay? And you fix one obstruction at a time. You cannot fix them all. Okay? That's all. You can, and sometimes you can't fix at all. So you patiently endure the suffering and don't let it bother you. No differently when someone who feels I'm so misunderstood, people really don't understand me at all, okay? It really bothers me. People are plotting to hurt me. People are plotting to harm me. It really bothers me, okay? That's when you feel that that is unfair, then your position should be to endure it. Because that's enduring it is part of cultivation. Cultivation is to endure what cannot be endured. If it bothers you, walk away. Okay? Go back to your room. Isolate yourself. Meditate, recite Buddha's name, recite One Yin Bodhisattva's name until you recover. After you recover, you go back out and let people abuse you again. And if it bothers you too much, walk away. Okay? Go back, hide somewhere, recite the Buddha's name, recite One Yin's name. You see, you cannot resolve all the problems. Sometimes you can only resolve it temporarily. And that is a real advantage because worldly people don't know even how to attain temporary relief for themselves. That's why they sink deeper and deeper and deeper. They cannot recover. Does it make sense? Same thing. You can do so much, okay? You can't take it anymore. Yield. Don't insist. It's just common sense. You cannot blindly cultivate. Cannot force it. Okay? There's so much you can do. Accept it. Okay? Then let people insult you. Endure the suffering. People misunderstand you. Tough luck. It's not the end of the world. You're not the only person who's misunderstood in the whole world. Okay? It shouldn't bother you. To endure it. Any questions or comments? Okay. And again, here's your advantage. This is very important point, number three. That is, I need to emphasize this for you. You're very fortunate because I'm telling you, look around you, there are plenty of people who are higher level than you. Meaning that the problem you have, they have been through similar problems and they can surpass those problems, overcome those problems, meaning there's hope for you as well. It's a matter of time. You hang around long enough, you'll be able to learn how to overcome your problems. But if you quit, you walk away, you will carry that problems with you wherever you go. You will not go away Because the problem, why is that? Because the problem is not because of others. The problem is because you mistake the false for the true. It's not because it's true or false. It doesn't matter what's true or false. It's you who perceive it to be a problem. It's no one's fault, but your fault. If you see it's an obstruction, okay, and it bothers you, it's because you perceive the obstruction to be true. Eventually, you'll be able to see that the obstruction is even false. So at that point, no obstruction will bother you at all. Does it help?
감사합니다, 스님.
Master.
What did you do, Catholic? The point here, furthermore, is that if something really, really upsets you personally, that you cannot get over, I'm available, we're available to talk to you. Don't feel you alone. Okay? Do not make the mistake like the losers who left because they couldn't take it anymore. Okay? I can tell you very proudly that we all care. Am I right or wrong? Except for one person here in the audience tonight, we all care. You know what I'm talking about. Okay? We all really care. You know, look around you. They may have a lot of faults. They may do a lot of things that are wrong. They may not be enlightened, but let me tell you what makes us, this great assembly, very wonderful to me. Because you are so special. Ching! And you're very kind, deep in your heart. Okay? Yeah. You may disagree, you may make mistakes, but inside our heart, that we're kind. Okay? And that's why you can talk. And if you don't like this person, you find another person, another person, another person. Eventually, so many of us around that you discover that actually we do care for each other. Don't feel you're alone. Don't feel that you are the only person who's badly treated and misunderstood. Okay? And finally, if that doesn't work, you talk to me. Because I rarely misunderstand people. Okay? Or do I rarely get bothered by obstructions? Does it help? No. We still have time. 3:56. He then ordered the disciples to light incense and bow before it and to recite it, thus enabling them to see the nature.
令门人住香敬礼敬敬诵此偈即得见性.
the translation is not very good from Chinese to English, but I don't care to correct it because I don't like the teaching. Okay? Because it's for low-level people. We're not here to do low-level people. Okay? But it's okay. Okay? So basically, the fifth patriarch, let me explain to you. There's a fifth patriarch. At this point, he looked at those people and said, you guys are losers. You guys are sheeps. Bleh. Okay? So let me tell you what. I tell you what. Just bow, light incense, okay, and recite it. Eventually, you see the Buddha nature. What he said is that it's true. However, he missed out between bowing, reciting it, until see the nature here. It's like, I can't even describe to you how far it is. This is nonsense instruction, you ask me. Okay, this is like, to me, it's false advertising. It's for babies. I have a hard time talking to you like this. Okay? Even if you're a baby, I have a hard time telling you that. All right? Anyway, 57, the disciples all recited it and exclaimed, excellent.
门人诵记 皆叹善哉.
Again, sheeps, who cares what they do? Yes, and number seven.
There's another YouTube question, which is not really related, but a new person, Gay Bodo, says, how to open your heavenly eye? Can you open it by meditating for a long time without being in full lotus or half lotus?
Yes. For a long, long time, you'll be able to. Actually, you don't even have to meditate. You still can open it. But I'm not going to tell you how. I'd rather you learn to meditate. All right. So the master says, light incense, bow to it, okay? And you recite it, okay? That's fine. And they say, oh, the sheep are said, his sheep disciples said, oh, this is so good. I mean, this verse is so wonderful because the fifth patriarch said so. Okay? And that's, to me, this is the cause of the trouble, because the fifth patriarch did not represent their truth to them. He basically said, you are excellent, you are beautiful, you are special, I love you all. Wait, I sound like a politician. But it's true, from my heart. Not. So this is a cause for troubles later, because he talked about he's sort of not giving them the proper cultivation instructions. These what I consider to be wrong cultivation instructions. And that's why later, these are the same disciples who would cause a lot of troubles for the sixth patriarch. But anyway, okay, it's just my personal opinion. 359, at the third watch, the patriarch called Sheng Xiu into the hall and asked him, did you write this verse?
祖三根幻秀入堂问曰：“既是汝作佛。”
360. Sheng Xiu said, "Yes, in fact, Xiu did it, I dare not uselessly seek to the patriarchy, but hope the High Master will be compassionate and see whether or not this disciple has a little bit of wisdom.
秀言实是秀作，不敢妄求主位，望和尚慈悲，看弟子有少智慧否。
The commentary in 361. So the patriarch called Sheng Xiuyan and said, very kindly, he's very kind at that point, I imagine, because he's looking at him, a person who's not qualified. Okay? So he said, very kindly asked him, did you write the verse? And Sheng Xiu said, yes, I did. Okay? And I know that I'm not quite there yet, but that's why I don't hope to be the next patriarch. However, I hope the master, the high master, will instruct me, make a comment about my verses. Okay, so this is after the fifth patriarch publicly declared the verses to be very good to his entire school, the entire temple. But when Sheng Xiu came to see him in private, Sheng Xiu is very humble. He says, yes, I don't think I quite got there yet. Please teach me. That is true. Because once you get there, you know. You don't get there, that's why you have all this hesitation, all this pondering, all this debate, all this discrimination. 362. The patriarch said, the verse which you wrote shows that you have not seen your original nature. You made it to the gate, but are still outside and did not get inside the gate.
祖曰，如作此偈，未见本性，直到门外，未入门内。
363. With such views and understanding, you may seek supreme Bodhi, but in the end will not obtain it.
如此见解，觅无上菩提，了不可得。
Okay, 364. So the patriarch, because he remember, Sheng Xiu was the one that asked the fifth patriarch to teach him. So when he asks, the fifth patriarch has to tell him the truth. Okay, has to teach him. Okay? And this is very Chinese style of teaching. This is very very lofty, very magnanimous of the fifth patriarch to speak to Sheng Xiu in that matter. He says, I will get to the point with you. Your verses indicate you have not seen your original nature, meaning you are not enlightened yet. You cannot see the truth yet. Okay? You made it to the gate, but are still outside, did not get inside the gate. This is a very important concept. Gate here refers to Dharma door. We have 84,000 Dharma doors in Chan as well. So every single Chan teacher, okay, will lead you, each and every one of you, to your own personal gate. It's wrong to assume that when you learn Chan, is you must do a huato, or you must do a mantra, or you must recite the Buddha's name, or and so on. Okay? Each one of you will have different gates at different times. Okay? And it's up to your Gutno advisor to bring you to that gate, depending on the conditions. So That's the nature of cultivation. Cultivation is very flexible. Sometimes part of your Dhamma door, part of your practice, is to be vigorous. Yes? Sometimes part of your practice has to be lax. Okay? So that's why the instructions are very flexible. You cannot force it. Meaning if I tell you to fight the sleepiness, it's because at the Chan Ho, you're supposed to do that. You understand that? Outside of Chan Ho, it's different, different environment. All right? So that's why cultivation, you need to be flexible. You cannot keep on forcing the issue. Sometimes you force the issue, okay? Sometimes you go around it. Sometimes you back off. Sometimes you jump over. There's no fixed things depending on the season, depends on the weather, depends on how much kimchi you ate, how much tostadas you had for lunch. You know what I mean? It varies every single day. It's never the same. That's why you have to be very flexible. Yes, Seven.
Cordelia asked, so should I sleep more and practice less so I'm not as exhausted?
That's a start. So what you ought to be doing in your personal case is that you increase the dosage gradually. Okay? Meaning that if you decide to sleep less, sleep 5 minutes less, 10 minutes less. Don't sleep like an hour less, 2 hours less. That's drastic. Your body needs time to adjust. So you adjust slowly. Very slowly. Very slowly. Okay? You see, if after a while of adjustments and you find that's more manageable, then continue. If you keep trying to sleep less and you still find yourself so drowsy after 4 weeks, after 3-4 weeks, okay? So for example, I would decrease my sleep. I sleep less by 5-10 minutes, okay? Only. And you have to be very patient. You sleep 5-10 minutes less so that you meditate more, for example. Okay? And see how it works out. Okay? Don't go immediately, you sleep an hour less. So I sleep 5-10 minutes less, and then I do it for 3 weeks, for a month, and see whether or not your body can adjust. That's part of the practice. You should ask these type of questions, okay? And if it works out, then that means you can sleep 5-10 minutes less. You stabilize the level. Then when you are stabilized, decrease again 5-10 minutes. That's a proper incremental changes. We want evolution. We don't want revolution. Okay? You want small changes, baby steps. Don't leap too soon before you're ready. All right. So this teaching here, going back to 364, part of your training is that, believe it or not, the good no advisor is supposed to look at you and see which gate you should be led to. So this is where I fault the fifth patriarch. He says, you made it to the gate, but are still outside, did not get inside the gate. OK? Okay? This is causing more confusions to Sheng Xiu, the poor guy. It's just like, I've been leading you, I've been taking you time, but you're so stupid. You are not enlightened yet. How does it help you? You understand? That's a problem I have with the Chinese instructions. If you tell me that I made it to the gate, please tell me which gate. I'm very Americanized, excuse me, folks. I hate it when people give me abstract instructions. Okay? Which gate are we talking about? If I were Sheng Xiu, I said, question? Please don't be offended. Which gate are we talking about? Is it the same gate I have in mind as your gate? You understand the problem? The Chinese is gate, Dharma door. There's 84,000 Dharma doors. Which one are we talking about? This is not the time to be polite and be afraid to offend your teacher. You have to ask, which gate? Dear Reverend, dear High Master, which gate are we talking about? So he says, oh, it's the four, two hands and eyes. I say, okay, so I'm still at that gate. I'm still outside. Why could I not get inside the gate? Is the next question. Please don't tell me something I already know. I'm not inside yet. Tell me why not. You, the High Master, why you keep on saying things I already know? I'm not inside. You don't have to remind me. Because reminding me makes you feel more inadequate. It doesn't help my cause. Doesn't help my self-esteem. So you tell me I'm not inside. So I've been following you for 20 years and still not inside? So I'm a loser? I'm a sheep? Or what? Spit it out. It's not time to be Chinese. Oh, wait. We're in China, weren't we? We're not in China anymore. That's why I'm being blunt with you. Okay? You cannot talk to Americans this way. They will revolt. They say, hey, you guys lack precision. With such views and understanding, what views? What understanding? My poem. You remember the poem? The body is a Bodhi tree. The mind is like a mirror stand. Time and time again, brush it clean. Do not let dust alight. Hey, ding! I hate the poem, but I somehow remember right now. It's a stupid poem. So my mind must be stupid. So, that poem in your mind has many views. Body is Bodhi tree, mind's mirror stand. Do not let dust get on the mirror. Okay? So you sweep it. Which view is wrong? Please tell me. You patriarch, I'm not. Tell me. What are you afraid of? That I run over to the other church? Because if I run, of course, I may seek Supreme Bodhi and will not obtain it. Another truth I already know. Okay, Chinese people, are you offended? That I am attacking your fifth patriarch, the one you revered? What about Americans? You like it when I attack the Chinese fifth patriarch? sacrilegious, right? Come on. Anyone has the right to ask and speak their minds. This is why it's called Buddhism. Just because you're a patriarch, you have to earn your place, man. You hear me? You have to earn your place. You have to earn your title. You have to deserve it. You have to do things every day to deserve it. Okay? Again, I feel sorry for Sheng Xiu. And because of this poor instructions, these reluctance to be specific and tell their followers, his followers, things that they didn't want to listen to, that's why these followers later went after the sixth patriarch and tried to kill him. Personally, I feel it's the fifth patriarch's fault. Because whose disciples tried to kill the fifth patriarch? I mean, sixth patriarch, excuse me. Fifth patriarch's disciples. Seven.
Jane has a comment on the gate. She says, the gate here is quite general. In Chinese language, rumen, entering the gate, can refer to entryway of any subject. For example, entry-level carpentry.
No, this is not about general knowledge. This is about fa men is not rumen. Okay? This is very specific Buddhist concept. When I teach you, I bring you this Dharma door that's called a gate. Men here is a gate, is called fa men, Dharma door. Okay? I bring you there. Very specific. Which ones? Okay? And now, not do I need to bring you there, I need to also kick the butt. Sometimes you don't want to get in, so that's when, because you're ahead of me, I'll your butt. And you say, hey! And guess what? When you least expect it, hey, you a patriarch and you kick my butt? What kind of patriarch are you? And boom! You cross the gate. Did you have a comment, questions, sir? Okay, so it's not rumen as a Chinese, common Chinese thing. This is very Buddhist concept. It's very Chan concept. It's very Mahayana. Okay. Time is up. We will continue with 365 next time. Thank you all, and good night.